Hey, I'm Scott Monty.
Hi, this is Chris Brogan.
Hi, I'm Darren Rouse.
I'm Steve Rebell.
Hi, I'm Mari Smith, and you're watching Social Media Examiner TV.
Michael Stelzner here from Social Media Examiner, and I'm joined by Jason Falls, founder and principal of Social Media Explorer. Jason, how are you doing today?
Doing great, Michael. Thanks for having me.
Excellent. Jason is an expert in helping large corporations figure out their social media strategies. Jason, let's start with kind of some of the big mistakes that you see businesses making that are kind of dipping their toes into social media. What are some of the mistakes you see them making?
Well, the first mistake that most companies make is that they don't listen first. And listening is such a big key to being successful in social media. You not only have to listen to your current customers, but you also have to listen to what people are saying about your company, about your product or service, but also about your competition and about your industry on the internet. And so diving into social media in any form or fashion, whether it be a corporate blog or whether it be participating on social networks, Twitter, Facebook, so on and so forth, without first understanding what people are saying, it puts you in a bad position because then you don't know what to add to the conversation. And social media is really about adding to the conversation, not blasting a message.
So the mistake that most people are making is they're just promoting like they would normally over other channels, like come to this or subscribe to this, and that's not really resonating in the social media world.
Exactly, correct? Exactly. The old school traditional way of communications and marketing is really a one way, send out a message to as many people as you can possibly hit and hope that a few of them get it.
Right.
Social media kind of inverts that a little bit and says we're going to talk to one person, one-on-one, one customer, one fan, one consumer, and give them the tools, give them the incentive they need to tell our story to someone else, to share that with their friends. It's all about recommendations and referrals in social media. And so instead of sending a blast message out to a bunch of people and hoping a few get it, you have one-on-one conversations, which implies that you have to listen and speak. So there's a two-way track there. It's no longer a monologue, it's a dialogue. And I would even argue that it's a multi-log, which is a term that I use to describe the fact that you can talk to your customers can talk to you, but your customers can talk to each other while you watch and listen. And so that's a very, very powerful tool for companies.
Interesting. Talk to me about the PR side of things. For businesses that want to try to leverage social media for PR, what would be some tips or advice you would give?
Sure. I think social media in a lot of ways has sort of its DNA is rooted in public relations. Because public relations, if you really chop that term down, it's all about building relationships. That's where the relations comes in. And social media is very much about building long-term lasting relationships with customers. And so if your public relations team is moving into a social media setting, they need to monitor and listen just like they monitor traditional media.
Right.
Instead of monitoring traditional media and then putting together a clip book or a report for your CEO, now you have what I would call active monitoring. You're listening to conversations that are going on the web and you're participating in them on behalf of the company or the brand.
What are you looking for when you're listening?
Well, you're looking for anybody who mentions you positively or negatively, or in an indifferent tone as well. If you see someone who's talking positively about you, thank them, or say, well, we're glad to know that we've got such great, customers or fans out there. Is there anything we can do to, help you spread the good word about our product or service? If they're saying something bad about you, you have to kind of dissect that a little bit better because you don't want to necessarily engage a detractor, someone who's just trying to talk bad about you to talk bad about you. Because there's that ilk out there on the internet that exists, although in very much more small numbers than we've ever thought. But if they're talking bad about you, more than likely there's some sort of nugget of truth or some root to that negative opinion that it's great for you to understand and embrace and help your company get better. And so by listening to the negative and reaching out to them, saying, I'm sorry you had a bad experience, what can I do to help? You can only get better from that.
And that's kind of a counterintuitive for a lot of businesses, right? They would rather not be public about that kind of stuff.
It is counterintuitive, but what you have to understand, this goes back to the multi-log conversation. It's not just that you're having a conversation with that detractor or that person who has a negative opinion of you, and not just that they're having a conversation with you, but other people are watching that conversation. So by simply participating in that conversation, you immediately sort of multiply the sort of good vibes around your brand because people see they're listening, they're being responsive, they're trying to address concerns. I like the fact that there's someone with that company I can reach out to.
Jason, looking forward a year from now, where do you see things changing? What's going to be happening, you think, in a year from now? Put your profit hat on.
There's this sort of among the I guess the thought leaders and the, you know, elite in the or the experience, not the elite, in the social media business. There's this push now to talk about taking social media from this kind of tactical, you know, list of things to do to market your product or service, and moving social thinking a little bit higher level and trying to integrate it across the enterprise and become a social business. And sort of the philosophy and the thinking there is, if you give people who are customers of yours an opportunity to not just gather around your brand, but gather around your brand in ways that aren't necessarily brand-centric, but are consumer-centric. So a good example would be, for instance, Panera Bread. I think Panera Bread is building themselves up to be a social business. It's not just about good food. It's not just a restaurant where you go and you sit and you have a meal. They have free Wi-Fi, so people who are on the go, business people, will stop by and work for an hour in the afternoon and have a cup of coffee, or, you know, get a bagel or something of that nature. You'll see a lot of, groups of women or groups of men even, who will gather there on a Saturday afternoon, six or eight people, and just talk over a meal. They have turned themselves into a place where you can sit all day at a Panera Bread and they won't ask you to leave, because they're not trying to turn a turnstile.
Right.
They're trying to build community around their locations and make it a social business, so that it's more about coming there and buying good food and eating good food. It's about a gathering place for people in that neighborhood.
So what I hear you saying is that the next step is almost transcending the online world, or using the online world as a mechanism to get people to engage in the offline world.
Absolutely. The best social media programs out there take online networking and move it offline. Because at some point, I've had this theory for a while, and I don't know if I need to tweak it or not, because I've been saying this for a couple of years now. At some point, I think people are going to look up from their computer screens and realize, man, I haven't talked to another human being in 6 weeks. I need to go down to the corner store and have a face-to-face conversation with someone. And so I think the brands and the communities that transcend that pendulum swing back are going to be the ones that have great offline communities to complement the online activity.
Jason, what's next for you? What do you got in the pipeline?
I've got a lot of things happening. I'm consulting with a number of clients. I've got a couple of ideas for some longer form writing projects, maybe even a book on the horizon. And then I'm working on an online learning portal where people can come and learn some of the basic techniques of social media, and then even some more advanced topics that I'm going to build out. That's probably coming in the next 60 to 90 days, I would think.
Jason Falls, thank you very much.
Thanks, Michael. Appreciate it.